This week, we take a look at Lockjaw's intercooler, nestled under the Whipple Supercharger on our turnkey Duramax diesel. Banks built, protected by AMSOIL, with support from Roadster Shop and Nitto.
Hi guys, Gail Banks here. Next week, we're going to be researching lubricants for our upcoming turnkey engine program. So we're going back to AMSOIL. That means no Banks built next week. But I don't want you to miss the following one, so be sure to subscribe and hit that notification bell. Why the hell is it a bell anyway? All right, let's do this.
All right guys, we're back. And now that the cab is blown apart and on the Roadster Shop chassis, kind of, you'll see, we're gonna start getting back to the engine. So that means we're gonna work with Matt, the newest member of our mechanical engineering department. And I'm excited about this because Gail has wanted an L5P crate engine for, you know, since 2017 when it was released, and we've never really had a person solely dedicated to working on just a crate program until now. Matt comes from an aerospace engineering background, automotive engineering background, comes from gassers, so he's new to the diesel world, but even right here, I already see him working on the intercooler, so we're gonna jump right into it and talk packaging on this thing. Hey, Matt. All right, Matt, so right away, I'm noticing this thing is sitting way lower from when I last saw it. I see we got the new print on here, and yeah, last time we had that cast marine manifold, we were probably sitting at least 6-8 inches higher.
Oh, it might have even been higher than that. That thing was massive. That marine manifold has that massive intercooler in it that Gail designed.
The cylindrical core.
Yeah, exactly. And that thing is awesome. You know, you mentioned that I've come on board to manage the Banks crate engine program. And in an effort to do that and align Lockjaw with what we're going to produce for the customers, kind of reviewed everything that was going on with that whole intake and intercooler supercharger system, and went back to the CAD, kind of took another shot at it. And so this is where we're at right now. And of course, all this is a really iterative process where we're going to do CAD, we're going to 3D print stuff, we're going to fit it, we're going to see what's in the way, what's not in the way, how high can we go, how low can we go, and just kind of work through everything.
Right, so to expand off of what Matt's saying is, this is kind of, quote unquote, the predecessor of what our crate engine's going to be. So we obviously have a lot of packaging constraints with this, but we're going to see the same for guys who are going to put this on their own trucks. You know, we're going to sell them a turnkey piece, but at the same time, they need to be able to put it in whatever truck they want and know that it's going to fit up.
That's exactly right. And with Lockjaw, which is going to be freaking awesome, right? We're not as concerned with poking through the hood, but I think most customers who want to run the Banks turnkey engine are going to be cognizant of hood height. This particular manifold setup right now is set up for crank center line to top a blower to be right in line with an LSA. So that should clear most hoods out there in restomod trucks. That was one of the design constraints that we worked with in order to come up with this iteration of the manifold intercooler supercharger setup.
Yeah, because so many guys know they can fit an LS in it, but now we're going to give them another option.
Exactly. And another thing that you'll see that's different from what was here before and what has been talked about is the inlet. Now this, of course, is just a 3D printed manifold, but it's representative of what is going to be on here. And we're switching from rear inlet, and we're not going to run a jack shaft. We've been talking to Whipple, and they've given us some great advice and have been great partners on this project. We're setting up with a front drive, front inlet setup. We're still going to do some crazy stuff on it, and you'll see that coming. But this is the new configuration that we're headed down the road with.
And that'll be a lot easier for Sean, considering he's not going to have to tuck up on the tubs and come back around.
Yeah.
It'll just be a nice Y up front.
Yeah, exactly. And I really wanted to see his custom sheet metal work that he was going to do to, you know, talking about taking that round tubing and ovalizing it and coming around into a nice radiused inlet so that we don't get a lot of pressure drop going into the blower.
Right.
But now that we've done this setup, it's going to really streamline things. We get a nice straight shot coming out of the filter and right into the blower. So I think that's going to be advantageous, and it's going to work a lot better for turnkey engine customers in the future.
Right. So you mentioned front inlet and front drive. You want to jump on the CAD and show? I'm trying to envision how all this packages up front, and maybe it's a better idea to see it in CAD.
Well, I would love to show you all of that, but I don't have all the CAD done yet. I've been working with the guys at Whipple, and again, it's an iterative process,
yeah,
and we're going back and forth. But you can see on this CAD now, we've got the blower mocked up in here, the manifold mocked up, and this right here is going to be where our supercharger drive is.
So, okay, so it's going to be more or less concentric with the
It's going to be
pass or driver
on
side
the driver's side rotor, right? Because this is a twin screw blower that we're getting from Whipple to produce this engine, and that is where we're going to align our drive. Now you can also see in the CAD we've got our extra large pulley on here that is going to set our blower drive ratio. So we want a big pulley on it so that we can put as big a pulley as we can on the supercharger to get good belt wrap.
Right, 12 rib?
12 rib. And we want to get a pretty decent sized 3-inch or so supercharger pulley on here so that we can get plenty of belt engagement so that we don't end up with a slip on the belt, because you know we're going to turn this thing some RPM too.
Right. And another thing I'm noticing, which some guys may not see, is how we've kind of shifted this core back because the high pressure pump actually sits in the valley. On a stock engine, you can't really see it. There's so much covering it. But when we're trying to package everything down in the valley, I'm sure that's a big concern because you got fittings going to it, you've got sensors going to it. So you need room around there, but you still want to fit a massive core in the valley.
Yeah, and you know, and therein lies the rub, right? And that that's where the challenges are, is that we want to be able to run the factory high pressure fuel pump and in the factory location. So it becomes a really interesting design study and packaging at that point, because we need a certain amount of area on our intercooler in order to get enough cooling as we compress the air. So how do you do that and fit everything? And what we've come up with is that we bias the intercooler towards the rear of the motor, and we bias the supercharger towards the front. And that actually works because the way that these twin screw superchargers work,
the outlet will be more or less centered up though, although the overall supercharger is biased,
right?
The outlet is centered.
That's right. They have like a delta opening at the bottom of the blower at the outlet that is going to discharge like smack in the center of this motor. So that's another reason why it was advantageous for us to flip that blower around the inlet, the blower inlet around, because the delta then moves from the front of the motor to the back of the motor. So we can then position it well. And again, this is a study in packaging here, where we're trading this for this for this. And right now, I think what we've got is we've narrowed down our design field, and I think we're headed in a really good direction.
Now, how about, is this a single pass core? So are all the fittings going to be out back for the water?
Yeah, so the core is probably going to be designed this week.
Okay.
Right? We're doing this
real time.
Real time right now. And so the core will probably be designed this week. But yeah, it's what's in here and what's soon going to be in here is exactly what you're talking about, which is that what you're going to see in one of the upcoming episodes, we'll have water inlet and water outlet, either some fittings or a separate little water manifold that brings the water in and passes it through and brings it back out and takes it out to our heat exchanger out in front of the radiator. That's still being iterated right now.
Yeah, and even now, I mean, the cab's sitting on 2x4s, but it looks like it looks like the hood might even clear.
Yeah, this isn't the new lockjaw rat rod configuration. We needed to get the cab off of the stand it was on. And so what better place to put it than on the chassis? Because of this big old Allison transmission that we've got coupled up to the L5P, we're going to need to trim firewall. And you're the expert in that arena.
Right. So yeah, this actually is going to help me a lot, because before I was just going to kind of go for it and, you know, fit it back and forth and kind of clear as I go. But this will give me a nice idea of how much I need to make on the first pass and spend less time cutting, so we can get this thing in space, but not cut off too much so that Sean doesn't have anything to work with.
And it's important that you get that done, because we are up against, you mentioned it, we're up against a tight timeline on this thing. It's as we shoot this right now, it is the beginning of June, and SEMA is at the beginning of November. So we got a long way to go, and we don't have a lot of time to get there. So we got a lot of things. We got a big list of items, and we're going to be checking them off. And one of the next ones is get the truck to Sean.
Yeah, and we need a lot to be done to get it to Sean and have everything mocked up so that he can trust that when the real engine goes on and the real parts, it's not gonna clash with anything he's done, because he's got a lot of work ahead of him too.
Right, so I'm glad you brought up all of the parts that we need to do, because we're showing right now, we've got the engine mocked up, we've got the manifold, we've got the supercharger. We just talked about how we're gonna get the heat exchanger and the heat exchanger lines in here, but there's still a lot of pieces that are not on this motor. This is actually a different engine than you guys have seen in previous episodes. That engine is gonna go back on the dyno. This mock-up engine, we've been throwing parts on to get it to be basically a space claim so that all the sheet metal can be done. Again, a study in packaging, we're gonna have a supercharger drive over on this side. We're gonna have inlets, we're gonna have tubing coming. So
yeah, there's gonna be the whole drive assembly in and of itself is gonna
we're gonna have to do a whole new Fiat.
Yeah.
Yeah, so.
Reminiscent of the crazy super turbo Fiat that we have over there, out of the 3/4 inch plate.
Yeah, which is awesome, right? And you know, we'll recycle some of those ideas to go into this one. But we've got, you know, about a 4 weeks or so to get Fiat in CAD designed up and then printed and mocked into place and maybe iterated if necessary to get it ready to go off to get the sheet metal work done.
Yeah, and not only that, then we've got manifolds, exhaust, shit, I mean, the list goes on here.
Well, yeah, and so another thing that you may notice on this engine is that as we've talked about this particular engine in Lockjaw in the past, it's always been talked about as dry sump.
Right.
But again, in an effort to kind of align some things with the turnkey engine program, we're fitting up right now with a wet sump. And we got a few clearance issues.
Yeah, so trying to fit up with a wet sump.
Trying to fit up with a wet sump, but that's how building cars goes.
Yeah.
Our first effort didn't fit.
Yeah, I put this thing on this morning and we contacted the steering rack. So we pulled off the bottom pan, just mid pin nail. Still got the pickup, that clears, but it will need some clearancing up front where the steering rack lives to be able to bolt down to this guy.
Yeah, but a wet sump. So if we can make that fit, so we've got a few options here that we're gonna explore, that you guys will see coming up, about how we make a wet sump fit in here. And if we can get that figured out, which I think we can, then we'll probably use some of that space where the dry sump pump would have been right about here. And we may put the air conditioning compressor there instead, because we're gonna blow cold air out of this thing.
Thank you, Matt. I know you've got a lot to get back to. I've got stuff I've gotta get back to. You guys are gonna be seeing more of Matt as we make progress through this engine. We've gotta get this thing off to Sean in July. We've got SEMA coming up in November. No, I don't think that the plywood is the real wood floor. But like and subscribe, stay up to date. We've got a lot of work ahead of us.
We'll be back in 2 weeks. The guys are headed to Amsoil to research lubricants for the turnkey engine program. Subscribe and hit that notification bell so you don't miss another episode of Banks Built.